I'm going to show you a number sequence which is better than the Fibonacci sequence. And I know, I mean, I always say something is better than the Fibonacci sequence because I don't really like it. But in this case, this is something that is similar, but it uses a different rule. So the Fibonacci, just to remind everyone, you add 1 plus 1, that gives you 2. You add 1 plus 2, that gives you 3. And each time what you're doing is you're taking the previous 2, and then that gives you the next one 5, then you take those 2 and that gives you the next one 8, then you take those 2 and that gives you the next one 13, so I'm adding them in pairs. I'm going to do exactly the same thing, but instead of just adding them, I'm also going to copy the last one. So if I start 1, 1, right, so I'm going to add 1 plus 1 and that gives me 2, but then I'm going to copy the last one, which is a 1. Okay, the next pair is 1, 2, add them, you get 3, I'm going to copy the last one, which is a 2. Okay, now it's 2, 1. If I add them, I get another 3. The last one is a 1. Okay, 1, 3. Add them, I get a 4. The last one is a 3. Okay, 3, 2. Add them, I get a 5. The last one is a 2. Okay, 2, 3. And if I carry on like this, there's another 5. Last one is a 3. I keep going.
So this beast grows quicker than you can keep up with it.
Which is amazing, right? So with the Fibonacci, you're always at the end as you go along. This one's great because as you're copying it, the bit you're working on, like the end of it's racing away from you. And so I like that. And it's got a kind of syncopated kind of beat is how I feel, because you're not always adding, you're doing a bit of this and that. And so it's not moving at a regular rate. Well, you're running one at a time. Anyway, so I like it as a sequence. I think it's more interesting to generate and it requires a bit more concentration than just copying out the Fibonacci numbers. And you get these unusual numbers. This is called the Stern-Brocot sequence, or the Stern-Brocot numbers. You might think, well, what's so wonderful about, well, why would we want these? And so what you do now is you go back to the beginning of the Stern-Brocot numbers and you take them in pairs to form a fraction. So that first one, let's call that, actually let's mix it up with colors, let's go one. Okay, so let's take the first one as a fraction, that is 1/1. The next one as a fraction is 1/2. So I'm taking them numerator, denominator, all the way down in pairs. Next one's 2/1. Next one's 1/3. 3/2. 2/3. 3/1. And what will happen, I'm up to 1/4. If I carry that on, this will list out every possible fraction. This will list every single ratio of whole numbers. Not only that, it will always list them in their most simplified form. And it will only ever list them once each.
That's cool.
So nowhere, no fraction will appear twice, and no fraction will appear not as simple as it can be, and none will be missed. So this sequence gives you every single rational number in existence. There are reasons why we want to list out and order all the rational numbers. And actually, one of the early Numberphile videos, Infinity is Bigger Than You Think by the fine Dr. James Grime, in Gödel's proof that the rationals are the same size as the reals, it's a video worth watching, he uses a grid. And the grid, unfortunately, hugely inefficient because numbers appear in there more than once, they appear in the most simplified form. So you get a half, you also get 2/4, you get 4/8 and the rest. Whereas here, there's a half, no other fraction will ever appear, which equals a half. You get each one once and once only. This is really efficient. And this came out in a paper called Recounting the Rationals. So it was another way of counting the rationals. And they came up with this fantastic sequence, which then generates those fractions. But it's not the only way to do it. There's another way to generate every possible fraction without repeating them, and they always appear in the most simplified form. And what you do for that, start with the most simple fraction known to humankind, which is 1/1. Now we're going to have two children are going to come off this fraction, and one of them is going to inherit the top and one's going to inherit the bottom. And the missing number is going to be the sum of the numerator and the denominator. That's going to be a half and that's going to be 2/1. And then each of those are going to have kids. That one's going to inherit the top, that one's going to inherit the bottom, and that is the sum, and that is the sum. That one inherits the top, this one inherits the bottom, that's the sum, that's the sum. What you can see here, we are actually generating, here we go again, let's do another, this is getting a little bit bunched up, I'll try and even it out. That one gets the top, this one gets the bottom, that one gets the top, this one gets the bottom, that one gets the top, this one gets the bottom, that one gets the top, this one gets the bottom. That is the sum there and there, that is the sum there and there, and that is the sum there. And then this process, as you work your way down, will again list out every single fraction. It will list them all in the most simplified form, and it will not have any repeats. And you think, well, how am I going to read them off? Well, if you take a spiral, so we're going to start at 1, 1, and then we're going to go a half, and then 2 on 1, and then we're going to go through these, and then we're going to go through those. And if you take the sequence along that spiral, it goes 1 on 1, it's over here, then it goes a half, then it goes 2 on 1, then goes a third, then goes 3 2s, 2 thirds, 3 on 1, 1 quarter, and then it carries on. So this is generating exactly the same series of fractions that we got from the Stern-Brocot sequence. In fact, you could start with this, and then you could go back to those numbers. If you line up all the fractions, you'd find they pair up all the way along, cancel, remove the doubles, and you get back to the original sequence.
There are links to more from this interview and other videos on the topic here on the screen. If you'd like to know even more from Matt, you can also check out his book, Things to Make and Do in the Fourth Dimension, which was recently released. In fact, it's only just out in the US as I upload this. I will put a bunch of links in the video description. It's a really good book, plus a really good way to throw your support behind Matt.
So from this sequence, I know there are 3 ways to write 6 in binary if you're allowed to use 2s as well.
And if you just love the way Matt looks, and why wouldn't you, he's also depicted on the new Numberphile poster. I'll also pop a link to that in the video description.